Welcome. We're very glad to see you here today. I'm Nick Spitzer, co-director of the Kavli Institute for Brain and Mind here in La Jolla. And we have a wonderful program this afternoon. We're very happy that you're here to take it all in. I want to say a few words about the Kavli Institute for Brain and Mind as we start. In the little over a decade that we've been in business, we have been trying to bridge across different disciplines associated with understanding the brain. And so, as you can see here, we are trying to bring together people interested in cognitive science, psychology, on the one hand, with neuroscientists and neurologists, on the other hand, to bridge what has often been a set of silos separating the people, of course, all concerned with the same subject. Rusty Gage, Fred Gage, here joins me as co-director of the KIBM. Ralph Greenspan is our associate director. Since the announcement of the Brain Initiative in April 2013, the KIBM has launched a series of further initiatives, which are illustrated here, beginning with the Center for Brain Activity Mapping. One of the big threads of the Brain Initiative is to develop new technologies with which to map the connections within the brain. And this has been the focus of the Center for Brain Activity Mapping. In addition, Ralph Greenspan has reached north to Sacramento to the legislature there and achieved funding in the state budget of the state of California for CalBrain, again, a neurotechnology program for the now entire state of California. Most recently, the San Diego Brain Consortium here in San Diego has worked to bring together people from across the San Diego region to work on understanding the brain with new technology. In each of these cases, the goals are achieved by providing grants to bring together people and motivate them to work on these projects. The whole process is made possible by the Kavli Foundation, to which we are very grateful. They, as many of you will know, have been instrumental in pushing forward scientific research in a number of fields noted here, in addition to neuroscience. I should add that they also fund some very exciting prizes every other year, and we're very pleased that one of the co-chairs of the symposium today is Carla Schatz, who was a winner of the Kavli Prize in Neuroscience earlier this year. Robert Kahn, formerly a professor and dean here at the University of California, San Diego, is now president of the Kavli Foundation. Myung Chun is the executive vice president for scientific programs, and together the two of them have done a great deal to push forward scientific research across a wide range of disciplines. I want to add that the structure of this symposium is based on a series of symposia that have been going on for a long time. This afternoon, we are here together for the inaugural Kavli Symposium presented by the KIBM. But the Carta Symposia, which I know are familiar to a number of you, have really been a wonderful model for what we are doing here together today. They are focused on answering some of the big questions about human beings. Where did we come from? How did we get here? Ajit Varkey, Fred Gage, Margaret Schoeniger, and Pascal Gagneux run these symposia, and we're very happy to acknowledge their participation in helping us with our inaugural event. This brings us then to the program for today, the influence of early experience on the organization and function of the adult brain. This is a subject that's of great interest to everyone in the audience, and maybe there'll be some reflection back on our origins at earlier times. there was a point early in my career in which we thought that the brain could be understood either as some aspects regulated by genes and genetic programs, whereas other aspects of the brain's operation were regulated by activity, electrical activity. And now we appreciate, and I think this will be richly illustrated today, that genes and activity are very much partners with one another. And nature and nurture are, in fact, combined in these studies. So here will be some of the questions that we will be addressing during the course of the afternoon. How do the events of early development show up? What are the risks and opportunities of early development and their consequences for adult behavior? And finally, does identification of some critical windows at early stages of development provide opportunities for us to reopen those windows at a later stage in life? So with that, I'll turn the microphone over to Terry Sejnowski, who will give us a brief introduction for the opening of the afternoon.
We have a great group here today of speakers and a wonderful audience, so I'm really looking forward to all the talks. I want to, first of all, welcome you on behalf of the Salk Institute, Rusty Gage, my colleague who is a co-director of KIBM, and I'm also on the faculty here and at UCSD. So one of the great privileges of being here at the Salk was getting to know Francis Crick. And Francis told me the story once, and I think it might be a good way to get the symposium off on the right foot. He was giving a talk to a late audience, and the question period came up, and one of the ladies in the front row put her hand up and said, "Professor Crick, could you tell me what's the most exciting discovery that's been made in neuroscience?" And Francis thought for a moment and said, "Well, I think the most exciting thing that I can think of is that neuroscience has discovered that the brain is plastic." And she fainted straight away. And that's really the crucial mechanism for learning and memory, is the fact that the brain really is responsive to things, experiences you have, and as you'll see, not just during the day, but also at night. Now, we've picked speakers to give you a broad spectrum, all the way from the molecules up to the whole coordinated central nervous system that is responsible for all the behaviors you have, all the thoughts that you have, and your hopes and aspirations. And that's really, again, what Francis was trying to get across in his book, The Astonishing Hypothesis. Another incident, this is Ramachandran, who is a colleague now at UCSD, and is also a very, very prominent neuroscientist, once got a call from Francis. Francis was writing his book, and Francis says, "Rama, I have just gotten back from my editor, marked up first chapters, and she said that I ought to give it to a layman to read and get a feedback from a layman. Do you know any laymen?" So we're going to make an effort to try to make the science as accessible as possible. Thank you.